watching you right now. Atmosphere of heaven is healing you right now. Touching you, changing you, making all things new. Fresh oil flowing from heaven. Fresh oil flowing from heaven. Lift your hands and receive it. Oh, the atmosphere of heaven is touching you right now. The atmosphere of heaven is healing you right now. Restoring you, changing you, making all things new. It's fresh oil flowing from heaven. It's fresh oil flowing from heaven. It's fresh oil flowing from heaven. Lift your head. Everything you need is here. Everything you need is here. Thank you.
listen to my cry. Give it to my prayer, it does not rise from deceit. May my vindication come from you. May I see what is right, though you probe my heart and examine me at night. Though you test me, you will find there is nothing there. I reserve my mouth, it will not sin against you. As for the deeds of evil men, O Lord, by the word of your lips, I have kept myself from the ways of violent men. Keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. My steps have held onto your paths, my feet have not slipped. I call on you, O God, for you, O Lord. Answer me, show the wonder of your love, O Lord. Give your ear to my prayer, from enemies you save those who hide in you. Keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings. Keep me as the of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings.
And tonight we're continuing our series with a very important study. It's the topic of the unchangeable law. Well, as we always do, we're going to use a Bible story sort of as a springboard into this subject. If you look in your Bible in Daniel chapter 6, you'll recognize the story there. It's about Daniel, one of the great stories we often save for the children, Daniel in the lion's den. See, after the Babylonian kingdom fell to the Persians, the new Persian king, Darius, was so impressed with Daniel's ability and his wonderful spirit he had that he thought about making him the prime minister of his new kingdom. Well, you can imagine that didn't go over very well with the other members of Darius's cabinet, because Daniel was a former servant of Nebuchadnezzar. That was their enemy. Daniel was a former captive from among the Israelites. Why would the king want to promote somebody who was both a foreigner and a member of the former kingdom to be the new prime minister? So they came up with a plot. They went to King Darius and they said, "Your Highness, it's a new kingdom. We've conquered several other empires. In order to get everyone together, the best way to do that is through common worship." Now that's true. The devil often does that. When you can't get people to join together because of a common language, a common culture, common religion is often the best way to do it. And so they said, if you make a law, doesn't have to last long, just 30 days, that nobody worships any god except for you, that'll solidify the kingdom. You can read in Daniel 6:8, he signed the decree, can't pray to any god or man for 30 days, and by the way, there's a penalty if you break it, you go to the lion's den. But the king never dreamed anybody would break it, and he didn't realize what they were up to. So he signed it, and it says, according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which does not alter. Once you sign the king's law, can't change it. So, the Bible, this is one of the great verses in the Bible, Daniel 6, verse 10. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went to his house, his windows being open, in his chamber towards Jerusalem, and he knelt on his knees 3 times that day and prayed, and gave thanks before his God. Did Daniel know what the penalty was for this law? It says he knew about it, and he's still thanking God. He did nothing to hide his light under a bush, but he thought, I'm not going to hide my faith for anybody. And so he opened his windows. Well, soon, these enemies, they went to the king and they said, you know, that law that you signed? The king said, yeah, law of the Medes and the Persians cannot change. He said, well, there's someone in your kingdom that just doesn't care about your law. It's Daniel. He's praying three times a day. King Darius said, oh, no. Bible says he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver Daniel, but he couldn't, because he couldn't change his own law. So right about the going down of the sun, he had Daniel brought to the lion's den. Daniel says, the king spoke to Daniel and he put him in the lion's den. He said, I know that your God that you serve continually, he will deliver you. And they put a stone over the lion's den and they sealed it with a government seal. And then the next day, it tells us that early in the morning, the king came to the tomb and he said, they rolled away the stone. Daniel, has your God that you serve continually been able to deliver you from the lions? And Daniel said, my God has sent his angel and shut the lion's mouth. And no form of harm or hurt was on Daniel, the Bible says, because he believed in his God. Well, he had an interesting way of believing. He showed his belief, didn't he? That's what it says. He believed in God. Now, this story tells us that Daniel said, there are 10 commandments, and one commandment says, thou shalt not have other gods before me, not even King Darius, not even for 30 days. And he was willing to die rather than disobey. What kind of faith and determination do God's people need in the last days? Is there going to be a law that says he that does not worship the beast in his image should be killed? First, they can't buy or sell. But ultimately, it says they should be killed. And worshiping the beast in his image is going to require breaking one of God's commandments. Do you love the Lord and his word so much that you would rather die, rather go hungry than disobey? This is a test that we need to know that the Ten Commandments are not multiple choice. And that's our subject. Number one, can God's moral law be amended or repealed? Answer, Jesus tells us in Luke 16, verse 17, he says, it is easier for heaven and earth to what? Pass away than one little tittle of the law to fail. That's a Hebrew term. It's talking about the little crossing of a T. It's even smaller than the crossing of a T. Even the slightest thing, a jot or a tittle, like a little period or a little crossing of the T, says heaven and earth will pass away before even that much of the law passes away. You can also read in Psalm 89, verse 34, God says, my covenant I will not break, nor alter the thing that has gone out of my lips. God is not going to break his covenant. It's forever and ever. And then you have one more. In Psalm 111, verse 7 and 8, all of his commandments are sure. They stand fast forever and ever. The Ten Commandments did not suddenly appear in Exodus. The Ten Commandments have always existed because they are a reflection of God's nature. How do I know that? When the woman, Potiphar's wife, tempted Joseph to commit adultery in the book of Genesis, Joseph said, I can't do that. That's a sin. Did they know even in Genesis that adultery was a sin? When Cain killed Abel, God told him, sin lies at your door, and sin is the breaking of God's law. Was murder a sin even in the Garden of Eden? Or did murder wasn't a sin until God wrote it down at Mount Sinai? Of course it was. Was it wrong to lie all the way from the beginning? And so see, the Ten Commandments go all the way back. God simply codified it so that they would all know, very clear, no misunderstanding, approximately 300 words, this is my perfect will. That law is comprehensive for all man. It's not for one nation. It's for people everywhere. When you do away with the law of God, you're doing away with the nature of God. Yeah.
bow before your throne. As we come before your presence, we honor you alone. So we lift up our voices as trumpets heralding you. You are the King of glory. So this is what we do in humble adoration. Father, we bow before your throne. As we come before your presence, we honor you alone. So we lift up our voices as trumpets heralding you. Of glory. So this is what we do. We worship you today. We worship you today. We worship you today. We worship you today. Oh, we worship you today. We worship you today. We worship you today. We worship you today. Father, how we love you today. And we worship you just because of who you are. Oh, I wish I had somebody to help me sing in humble adoration.
In humble adoration, we bow before your throne.
Ooh.
As we come before your presence,
Father, we honor you.
We honor you alone.
So we lift up,
so
our voices as trumpets.
As trumpets hurling you.
So this is what
so
we do.
This is what we do.
In humble adoration.
In humble adoration.
Father, we bow before your throne.
As we come before your presence.
We honor you alone.
We honor you alone.
So we lift up our
so
voices.
We lift up our voices.
As trumpets heralding you. This is what we
so
do.
This is what we do.
We worship you today.
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 We worship you, Jesus.
We worship you today.
We worship you today.
We worship you today.
since the Bible says God is good. Do you know the Bible says also the law is good? The Bible tells us that God is holy. The Bible also says that the law is holy. You can read where it says God is righteous, God is truth, God is pure, God is spiritual, God is unchangeable, God is eternal. These are also all the same characteristics of the law. So we've got to be very careful about trying to do away with the law, because it represents the very nature of God. Jesus was the Word, became flesh. Christ said, he that hears these words of mine is building on a what? Wise man building on the rock. What were the Ten Commandments written on? If there are any words important, it would be the words of God engraven in stone. Christ was the embodiment of the Word. His life was obedience to the law of God. Now, according to the Bible, what is sin? I mean, Jesus came to save us from sin. What is it that he's saving us from? 1 John 3, verse 4. The Bible says, sin is the transgression of what? Of the law. Sin is, it's like a dictionary definition. Sin is the breaking of or the transgression of the law. Romans 3:20 said, by the law is the knowledge of sin. We don't really know what sin is except by the law. God's law reveals what sin is. Now, the purpose of the law, though, and this is a very important point I want to emphasize, is not to save us. The Bible says that the purpose of the law is to simply show us our need of salvation. Now, I'm going to just illustrate this. Now, I just did something to change my appearance. I don't see anything different. You see something different. Would it distract you if I went through the rest of the program like this? It would. So what do I need? Ah, how convenient. So I feel fine. I don't see there's a problem. I look in this device and I go, oh, it really is the first time I looked. That's kind of embarrassing. So since the mirror showed me I've got a problem, it obviously should be the means of removing the problem, right? So if I just whack myself in the head with the mirror, it'll all go away. Would that fix it? If I rub the mirror on the mark or the tape, will that take it away? This shows us the problem, but it's not supposed to take the problem away. You are not saved by keeping the law. The law doesn't save you from anything. The law is there to show us our need of salvation. But then if I take this and use the blood, it takes away the sin. Now, the reason I mention this, it says in the book of James, whoever looks into the perfect law that gives liberty and continues therein, being not just a hearer but a doer of the word, this man will be blessed. The law of God is compared to a mirror. It's not supposed to take away our sin. It's supposed to show us our need. Then you go to Jesus for cleansing. But if it's not a sin to break the law, if there's no law, there's no sin, right? The Bible says, where there is no law, there is no transgression. That's what Paul said. Where there's no law, there's no transgression. So if there is no law, there's no transgression. If there's no sin, then who needs a Savior? Can you see why the devil would be attacking the law? Because if there's no law, then there's no sin. If there's no sin, you don't need Jesus. And so that's the logic behind it. Number three, to what law is John referring to? Paul tells us in Romans chapter 7, verse 7. He said, I had not known sin but by the law, for I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. Here he's quoting from the Ten Commandments, isn't he? He's saying, I become aware of what my sin is by looking at the law.
The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. Testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yet and much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them your servant is warned, and in keeping great reward. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yet and much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by your servant is warned, and in keeping them there is great reward. And in keeping them there is great reward.
Did Jesus keep the Ten Commandments? John 15, verse 10, he said, I have kept my Father's commandments, and I abide in his love. We've got to have thy word I've hidden in my heart that I might not sin. We need to have the law of God in our heads and in our hearts, or we're going to get mixed up in this culture. Amen? Number five, what is the punishment for living a life of sin? Romans 6, 23, the wages of sin is death. Pretty serious. Sin is a deadly, contagious disease, and God has to use drastic measures. You know, we've seen in the news lately what happened when someone even thought someone else might have Ebola, because it's a deadly disease, roughly 50-60%, depending on what country you're in when you get it, that they quickly quarantine people. Well, sin is even more deadly than Ebola. And so God says we can't allow it to spread through the universe. The penalty is death. Unless we get a transfusion of the blood of Jesus, we're in trouble. Some say the Ten Commandments are not binding for New Testament Christians. What does Jesus say about this? Matthew 19, verse 17, he said, if you will enter into life, keep the commandments. Well, obviously, for a starting point, he would be talking about the Ten Commandments. You can read in John 14, verse 15, Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. A lot of pastors say today, we don't have to keep the Ten Commandments anymore because Jesus fulfilled the law. Well, what does fulfill mean? When Christ came to John the Baptist to be baptized, John said to Jesus, you need to baptize me because you're the Messiah. And Jesus said, no, John, allow it to be this way now, for thus it becomes us to fulfill all righteousness. So when Jesus said, fulfill all righteousness, does that mean do away with all righteousness? Some people read that verse, think not that I've come to destroy the law. They change it where Jesus says, think not that I've come to destroy the law. I've actually come to do away with it. That wouldn't make any sense. He obviously wants us to keep the Ten Commandments. How is it possible to keep the commandments? Now, sin is the transgression of the law. I don't know about you, but I am tempted every day. Am I alone? Every day I have opportunities to do the wrong thing. And every day I have opportunities to follow Jesus and make the right decision. Is it possible for us to do what God asks us to do? Romans 8, verse 3, God, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, which walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. It is possible. How much can I do through Christ? Without him, how much can we do? Nothing. Through Christ, all things are possible. What is the old covenant, and why did it fail? All right, first let's look and find out what that was. You go to Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 13, and you'll find the old covenant mentioned there. He declared unto you his covenant, which he commanded you to perform, even, how many? Ten commandments, and he wrote them on two tables of stone. And so it tells us that the old covenant was the Ten Commandments written on these two tables of stone, written by the finger of God. Now, right after the Lord made the covenant with the people, you know what a covenant is, and it's an agreement. God spoke the Ten Commandments there in Exodus 20. Moses later brings down the written copy. But while he's up on the hill getting the Ten Commandments, what do the children of Israel do? And so the Bible says in Hebrews 8, verse 8, for finding fault with them. Now, was the fault of the old covenant with the covenant and the law, or was it with the people who made a promise? See, the new covenant is based on better promises. The old covenant was based on the promise of the people. All the Lord has said, we will do it. The new covenant is based on the promise of the Lord. It says in Hebrews 8, verse 10, for this is the covenant that I will make with them, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write them in their hearts. And so God says he's going to put the law where? In the heart. He says, I'm going to write a different law in their heart. It's not a different law. Same law, different place. Same law, not their promises, his promise. Who spoke the first law? God did. Was the problem with the law or with the people? Does God ever command anybody to do something without giving them the power to do what he's asked them to do? Inherent in every command of God is built the power to perform what he's asking. That is a simple, if God says, I want you to walk across that ocean there, don't argue. You'll either walk on water like Peter, or he'll part the ocean. I mean, when God asks you to do something, you do it. And that's called obedience. And we're living in an age where even in some churches, they're acting like obedience is legalism. Obedience is not legalism. The devil is trying to intimidate Christians. As soon as you talk about the law, you know what you get called? A dirty word among Christians? Legalist. Pharisee. And so what happened is people in the church have been so intimidated by those terms, the pendulum has swung to the other side, and now everybody's so afraid to be accused of being a Pharisee or a legalist, nobody talks about the law. Jesus did. Doesn't living under grace by faith make keeping God's law non-essential? Romans 6:15, what then shall we sin because we're not under the law but under grace? What does he say? God forbid. And again, in Romans 3, verse 31, do we then make void the law through faith? Again, he uses that phrase, God forbid. Yea, we establish the law. Paul says in Romans chapter 2, 13, it's not the hearers of the law that will be just before God, but the doers of the law will be justified. That's what Paul said. Are people saved by keeping the law? You remember my illustration? Is anyone saved by keeping the law? No. Ephesians 2, verse 8 and 9, it says very clearly, for by grace are we saved through faith, not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. We're not saved by our obedience, but if we love the Lord, we'll want to obey him. You know, if you go to the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association website, he answers questions there. I just copied this off the website because Dr. Graham still has this right. Question, does God expect us to keep the Ten Commandments? Answer, The Ten Commandments are just as valid today as when God gave them to Moses over 3,000 years ago. Jesus said, I tell you the truth, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of the pen will by any means disappear from the law. And he's got a number of other statements like that. There's not a lot of preachers that are still saying that. They're all saying, we're not under the law. And that is a really strange thing because it makes it sound like sin is being endorsed.
Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties. And see if there is any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Try me and know my anxieties, and see if there is any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting, and lead me in the
sing to the Lord.
What are some of the glorious rewards of keeping God's law? Proverbs 29, verse 18. This is as simple as it gets. How can you misunderstand this one? He that keeps the law, happy is he. Anyone here want to be happy? The Bible says there's joy, there's blessing, there's happiness, there's abundance. This doesn't come from disobedience. It comes from trusting the Lord and obeying him. And that's what I want to do. That's where I want to be. Furthermore, Psalm 119, verse 165, not any kind of peace, but what kind of peace? Great peace have they that love thy law, nothing will offend them. Don't you want to have that kind of peace when you say, Lord? And you know, if you're struggling, as we all do, you just tell the Lord, Lord, I want to obey you. I want to be your child. I want to be willing to do your will. You know, God sends this message to us because he wants to save us, but he can't force us. Back in 1995, a young man did something awful. It's just immature jealousy. There were a couple that were parked out in an isolated spot in a car. And I guess this young man, Andrew Allen Cook, felt jilted, but he shot to death these young college student and the girl, and nobody knew what happened. It was a mystery. The FBI got involved. They couldn't figure out who did it or who was responsible. But at one point, Bureau of Investigation in Georgia began to ask some questions, and they called a guy named John Cook, and they said, could you have your son, Andrew, give us a call? We want to ask him some questions to see if he knows anything about that murder that took place. And so John called his son. He said, Andrew, he says, the Bureau of Investigation in Georgia is wanting to ask you some questions about that murder. And he said, yeah, Dad, I did it. Now, I didn't tell you that his father was an FBI agent. They had no evidence on him. There was no witnesses. The only one who knew was the father. The father was a Christian. Loved his son. He had to make a decision. He knew he'd get the death penalty. And he said, do I put the law above the love for my son? And he realized there is no love if there isn't law. And what about the parents that lost their children? And he said, son, you know what I have to do. The primary witness during that trial was John Cook, witnessing against his son that he desperately loved. And 2013, Andrew was executed for his murders. God wants to save you. He's desperate to save you. But he also is a just God, and he cannot save you if you will not come to him and ask him to save you from your sins.
A chosen generation, one who is set apart and belonging to God, one who is willing to say no to the way of this world, one who declares the praises of him, the Christ, who calls you out of darkness into his wonderful light. It's you. It's me. Let's go.
You did it. You did it. Didn't have to do it, but you did it. You made your life down for me, and I know that you died, yeah. Oh, you died. So I can live today in reverence your ways. I know I must learn to stop, pick up my cross, and live for you. Learn to be like you. In your presence I hope to remain. But then I think about your sacrifice. I'm grateful that you left your throne to pay the price. You bled and died for you, my life. You've been good to me. You showed humility. Oh, oh. Set apart. I'm chosen from this world to reach out to the world. I'm chosen to set free. Chosen for your will. Chosen, set apart for your glory. It's a chosen generation. Set apart. I'm chosen from this world to reach out to the world. I'm chosen to set free. Chosen for your will. Chosen, set apart for your glory. It's a chosen generation. You set the pace by dying, and now I live and breathe to serve you alone, my King. I know I must let go, the word and I no more. Oh. And yes, I live today to reverence your ways. I know I must learn to stop, pick up my cross.
Cross.
And live for you, learn to be like you. In your presence I hold today. But then I think about your sacrifice. I'm grateful that you left your throne to pay the price. You bled and died for you, now I have life. You've been good to me, you showed your to reach out to the world. I'm chosen to set free. Chosen for your will. Chosen, set apart for your glory. It's a chosen generation. Set apart. I'm chosen from this world to reach out to the world. I'm chosen to set free. Chosen for your will. Chosen, set apart for your glory. It's a chosen generation. I live and breathe. I live and breathe to serve you. I live and breathe. I live and breathe to serve you. I live and breathe. I live and breathe to serve you. I live and breathe. I live and breathe. I live and breathe to serve you. I live and breathe. I live and breathe to serve you. I live and breathe. I live and breathe to serve you. Hey, it's a chosen generation. Whoa. Set apart. I'm chosen from this world to reach out to the world. Chosen, hey. To set free. Chosen for your will. Chosen, set apart for your glory. Yeah. It's a chosen generation.
Oh,
one goes out to you, Israel. Oh yeah. I know you've been conditioned to do the things you do. I know you've been conditioned to think the way you do. But it's high time, come out of sleep and reclaim your nationality. 'Cause you're not like all these other people. You are Israel, you're a set apart people. Lost in the faith of his son, the black Messiah. And don't join in but these other nations, they're not like you. You're a set apart people. Oh yeah, come out of her. You're a set apart people. Separate and rely on your own people. 'Cause as you look around, we're not equal. Israel, there's gonna come a day when we will see Christ. And he's not just saving you, but us together. You're a set apart people.
Inspired by the Bible Experience. Balaam said,
"Build me 7 altars here, and prepare 7 bulls and 7 rams for me."
Balak did as Balaam said,
and the two of them offered a bull and a ram on each altar. Then Balaam said to Balak,
"Stay here beside your offering while I go aside. Perhaps the Lord will come to meet with me. Whatever he reveals to me, I will tell you."
Then he went off to a barren height. God met with him, and Balaam said,
"I have prepared 7 altars, and on each altar I have offered a bull and a ram."
The Lord put a word in Balaam's mouth and said,
"Go back to Balak and give him this word."
So he went back to him and found him standing beside his offering with all the Moabite officials. Then Balaam spoke his message.
"Balak brought me from Aram, the king of Moab from the eastern mountains. Come," he said, "curse Jacob for me. Come, denounce Israel. How can I curse those whom God has not cursed? How can I denounce those whom the Lord has not denounced? From the rocky peaks I see them, from the heights I view them. I see a people who live apart and do not consider themselves one of the nations. Who can count the dust of Jacob or number the fourth part of Israel? Let me die the death of the righteous, and may my final end be like theirs."
Balak said to Balaam,
"What have you done to me? I brought you to curse my enemies, but you have done nothing but bless them."
He answered,
"Must I not speak what the Lord puts in my mouth?"
Then Balak said to him,
"Come with me to another place where you can see them. You will not see them all, but only the outskirts of their camp. And from there, curse them for me."
So he took him to the field of Zophim on top of Pisgah. And there he built 7 altars and offered a bull and a ram on each altar. Balaam said to Balak,
"Stay here beside your offering while I meet with him over there."
The Lord met with Balaam and put a word in his mouth and said,
"Go back to Balak and give him this word."
So he went to him and found him standing beside his offering with the Moabite officials. Balak asked him,
"What did the Lord say?"
Then he spoke his message.
"Arise, Balak, and listen. Hear me, son of Zippor. God is not a human, that he should lie, not a human being, that he should change his mind. Does he speak and then not act? Does he promise and not fulfill? I have received a command to bless. He has blessed, and I cannot change it. No misfortune is seen in Jacob, no misery observed in Israel. The Lord their God is with them. The shout of the king is among them. God brought them out of Egypt. They have the strength of a wild ox. There is no divination against Jacob, no evil omens against Israel. It will now be said of Jacob and of Israel, see what God has done. The people rise like a lioness. They rouse themselves like a lion that does not rest till it devours its prey and drinks the blood of its victims."
Then Balak said to Balaam,
"Neither curse them at all, nor bless them at all."
Balaam answered,
"Did I not tell you I must do whatever the Lord says?"
Then Balak said to Balaam,
"Come, let me take you to another place. Perhaps it will please God to let you curse them for me from there."
And Balak took Balaam to the top of Peor, overlooking the wasteland. Balaam said,
"Build me 7 altars here and prepare 7 bulls and 7 rams for me."
Balak did as Balaam had said and offered a bull and a ram on each altar. Now when Balaam saw that it pleased the Lord to bless Israel, he did not resort to divination as at other times, but turned his face toward the wilderness. When Balaam looked out and saw Israel encamped tribe by tribe, the Spirit of God came on him, and he spoke his message.
"The prophecy of Balaam, son of Beor, the prophecy of one whose eye sees clearly, the prophecy of one who hears the words of God, who sees a vision from the Almighty, who falls prostrate, and whose eyes are opened. How beautiful are your tents, Jacob, your dwelling places, Israel. Like valleys they spread out, like gardens beside a river, like aloes, planted by the Lord like cedars beside the waters. Water will flow from their buckets. Their seed will have abundant water. Their king will be greater than Agag. Their kingdom will be exalted. God brought them out of Egypt. They have the strength of a wild ox. They devour hostile nations and break their bones in pieces. With their arrows they pierce them. Like a lion they crouch and lie down. Like a lioness, who dares to rouse them? May those who bless you be blessed, and those who curse you be cursed.
Then Balak's anger burned against Balaam. He struck his hands together and said to him,
I summoned you to curse my enemies, but you have blessed them these three times. Now leave at once and go home. I said I would reward you handsomely, but the Lord has kept you from being rewarded.
Balaam answered Balak,
did I not tell the messengers you sent me? Even if Balak gave me all the silver and gold in his palace, I could not do anything of my own accord, good or bad, to go beyond the command of the Lord. And I must say only what the Lord says. Now I am going back to my people, but come, let me warn you of what this people will do to your people in days to come.
Then he spoke his message.
The prophecy of Balaam, son of Beor, the prophecy of one whose eye sees clearly, the prophecy of one who hears the words of God, who has knowledge from the Most High, who sees a vision from the Almighty, who falls prostrate, and whose eyes are open. I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star will come out of Jacob. A scepter will rise out of Israel. He will crush the foreheads of Moab, the skulls of all the people of Sheth. Edom will be conquered. Seir, his enemy, will be conquered. But Israel will grow strong. A ruler will come out of Jacob and destroy the survivors of the city.
Then Balaam saw Amalek and spoke his message.
Amalek was first among the nations, but they will come to ruin at last.
Then he saw the Kenites and spoke his message.
Your dwelling place is secure. Your nest is set in a rock. Yet you Kenites will be destroyed when Asher takes you captive.
Then he spoke his message.
Ah, who can live when God does this? Ships will come from the shores of Cyprus. They will subdue Asher and Eber. But they too will come to ruin.
Then Balaam got up and returned home. And Balak went his own way. While Israel was staying in Shittim, the men began to indulge in sexual immorality with Moabite women, who invited them to the sacrifices to their gods. The people ate the sacrificial meal and bowed down before these gods. So Israel yoked themselves to the Baal of Peor, and the Lord's anger burned against them. The Lord said to Moses,
take all the leaders of these people, kill them, and expose them in broad daylight before the Lord, so that the Lord's fierce anger may turn away from Israel.
So Moses said to Israel's judges,
each of you must put to death those of your people who have yoked themselves to the Baal of Peor.
Then an Israelite man brought into the camp a Midianite woman right before the eyes of Moses and the whole assembly of Israel while they were weeping at the entrance to the tent of meeting. When Phinehas, son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the priest, saw this, he left the assembly, took a spear in his hand, and followed the Israelite into the tent. He drove the spear into both of them, right through the Israelite man and into the woman's stomach. Then the plague against the Israelites was stopped, but those who died in the plague numbered 24,000. The Lord said to Moses,
Phinehas, son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron the priest, has turned my anger away from the Israelites. Since he was as zealous for my honor among them as I am, I did not put an end to them in my zeal. Therefore tell him, I am making my covenant of peace with him. he and his descendants will have a covenant of a lasting priesthood because he was zealous for the honor of his God and made atonement for the Israelites.
The name of the Israelite who was killed with the Midianite woman was Zimri, son of Salu, the leader of a Simeonite family. And the name of the Midianite woman who was put to death was Cozbi, daughter of Zer, a tribal chief of a Midianite family. The Lord said to Moses,
"Treat the Midianites as enemies and kill them. They treated you as enemies when they deceived you in the Peor incident involving their sister Cozbi, the daughter of a Midianite leader, the woman who was killed when the plague came as a result of that incident."
After the plague, the Lord said to Moses and Eleazar, son of Aaron, the priest,
"Take a census of the whole Israelite community by families. All those 20 years old or more who are able to serve in the army of Israel."
So on the plains of Moab, by the Jordan, across from Jericho, Moses and Eleazar, the priest, spoke with them and said,
"Take a census of the men 20 years old or more, as the Lord commanded Moses."
These were the Israelites who came out of Egypt. The descendants of Reuben, the firstborn son of Israel, were through Hanok, the Hanokite clan, through Palu, the Paluite clan, through Hezron, the Hezronite clan, through Carmi, the Carmite clan. These were the clans of Reuben. Those numbered were 43,730. The son of Palu was Eliab, and the sons of Eliab were Nemuel, Dathan, and Abiram. The same Dathan and Abiram were the community officials who rebelled against Moses and Aaron, and were among Korah's followers when they rebelled against the Lord. The earth opened its mouth and swallowed them along with Korah, whose followers died when the fire devoured the 250 men. And they served as a warning sign. The line of Korah, however, did not die out. The descendants of Simeon by their clans were through Nemuel, the Nemuelite clan, through Jamin, the Jaminite clan, through Jachin, the Jachinite clan, through Zerah, the Zerahite clan, through Shaul, the Shaulite clan. These were the clans of Simeon. Those numbered were 22,200. The descendants of Gad by their clans were through Zephon, the Zephonite clan, through Haggi, the Haggite clan, through Shunai, the Shunite clan, through Osni, the Osnite clan, through Eri, the Erite clan, through Arudai, the Arudite clan, through Areli, the Arelite clan. These were the clans of Gad. Those numbered were 40,500. And Onan were sons of Judah, but they died in Canaan. The descendants of Judah by their clans were through Shelah, the Shelahite clan, through Perez, the Perezite clan, through Zerah, the Zerahite clan. The descendants of Perez were through Hezron, the Hezronite clan, through Hamuel, the Hamulite clan. These were the clans of Judah. Those numbered were 76,500. The descendants of Issachar by their clans were through Tola, the Tolaite clan, through Pua, the Puite clan, through Jashub, the Jashubite clan, through Shimron, the Shimronite clan. These were the clans of Issachar. Those numbered were 64,300. The descendants of Zebulun by their clans were through Sirah, the Sirahite clan, through Elon, the Elonite clan, through Jaleel, the Jaleelite clan, These were the clans of Zebulun. Those numbers were 60,500. The descendants of Joseph, by their clans, through Manasseh and Ephraim, were the descendants of Manasseh through Machir, the Machirite clan. Machir was the father of Gilead, through Gilead, the Gileadite clan. These were the descendants of Gilead, through Iezer, the Iezerite clan, through Helik, the Helikite clan, through Asriel, the Asrielite clan, through Shechem, the Shechemite clan, through Shemida, the Shemidaite clan, through Hefer, the Heferite clan. Zelophehad, son of Hefer, had no sons. He had only daughters, whose names were Mala, Noah, Hagla, Milcah, and Tirzah. These were the clans of Manasseh. Those numbered were 52,700. These were the descendants of Ephraim by their clans, through Shuthelah, the Shuthelahite clan, through Beker, the Bekerite clan, through Tahan, the Tahanite clan. These were the descendants of Shuthelah, through Iran, the Iranite clan. These were the clans of Ephraim. Those numbered were 32,500. These were the descendants of Joseph by their clans. The descendants of Benjamin by their clans were through Bela, the Belaite clan, through Ashbel, the Ashbelite clan, through Ahiram, the Ahiramite clan, through Shupham, the Shuphamite clan, through Hupham, the Huphamite clan. The descendants of Bela through Ard and Naaman were through Ard, the Ardite clan, through Naaman, the Naamite clan. These were the clans of Benjamin. Those numbered were 45,600. These were the descendants of Dan by their clans, through Shuham, the Shuhamite clan. These were the clans of Dan. All of them were Shuhamite clans, and those numbered were 64,400. The descendants of Asher by their clans were through Imnah, the Imnite clan, through Ishvi, the Ishvite clan, through Beriah, the Beriahite clan, and through the descendants of Beriah, through Heber, the Heberite clan, through Malkiel, the Malkielite clan. Asher had a daughter named Sirah. These were the clans of Asher. Those numbered were 53,400. The descendants of Naphtali by their clans were through Jaziel, the Jazielite clan, through Gunai, the Gunite clan, through Jezer, the Jezerite clan, through Shillem, the Shillemite clan. These were the clans of Naphtali. Those numbered were 45,400. The total number of the men of Israel was 601,730. The Lord said to Moses,
"The land is to be allotted to them as an inheritance, based on the number of names. To a larger group, give a larger inheritance, and to a smaller group, a smaller one. Each is to receive its inheritance according to the number of those listed. Be sure that the land is distributed by lot. What each group inherits will be according to the names for its ancestral tribe. Each inheritance is to be distributed by lot among the larger and smaller groups."
These were the Levites who were counted by their clans, through Gershon, the Gershonite clan, through Kohath, the Kohathite clan, through Merari, the Merarite clan. These also were Levite clans, the Libnite clan, the Hebronite clan, the Malite clan, the Mushite clan, the Korahite clan. Kohath was the forefather of Amram. The name of Amram's wife was Jochebed, a descendant of Levi, who was born to the Levites in Egypt. To Amram, she bore Aaron, Moses, and their sister Miriam. Aaron was the father of Nadab and Abihu, Eleazar and Ithamar. But Nadab and Abihu died when they made an offering before the Lord with unauthorized fire. All the male Levites a month old or more numbered 23,000. They were not counted along with the other Israelites because they received no inheritance among them. These are the men counted by Moses and Eleazar the priest when they counted the Israelites on the plains of Moab by the Jordan, across from Jericho. Not one of them was among those counted by Moses and Aaron the priest when they counted the Israelites in the desert of Sinai. For the Lord had told those Israelites they would surely die in the wilderness, and not one of them was left except Caleb, son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, son of Nun. The daughters of Zelophehad, son of Hepher, the son of Gilead, the son of Machir, the son of Manasseh, belonged to the clans of Manasseh, son of Joseph. The names of the daughters were Mahla, Noah, Hogla, Milcah, and Tirzah. They came forward and stood before Moses, Eleazar the priest, the leaders, and the whole assembly at the entrance to the tent of meeting, and said,
"Our father died in the wilderness. He was not among Korah's followers who banded together against the Lord, but he died for his own sin and left no sons. Why should our father's name disappear from his clan because he had no son? Give us property among our father's relatives."
So Moses brought their case before the Lord, and the Lord said to him,
"What Zelophehad's daughters are saying is right. You must certainly give them property as an inheritance among their father's relatives, and give their father's inheritance to them. Say to the Israelites, if a man dies and leaves no son, give his inheritance to his daughter. If he has no daughter, give his inheritance to his brothers. If he has no brothers, give his inheritance to his father's brothers. If his father had no brothers, give his inheritance to the nearest relative in his clan, that he may possess it. This is to have the force of law for the Israelites, as the Lord commanded Moses."
Then the Lord said to Moses,
"Go up this mountain in the Abarim range and see the land I have given the Israelites. After you have seen it, you too will be gathered to your people, as your brother Aaron was. For when the community rebelled at the waters in the desert of Zin, both of you disobeyed my command to honor me as holy before their eyes."
These were the waters of Meribah Kadesh in the desert of Zin. Moses said to the Lord,
"May the Lord, the God of every human spirit, appoint someone over this community to go out and come in before them, one who will lead them out and bring them in, so the Lord's people will not be like sheep without a shepherd."
So the Lord said to Moses,
"Take Joshua, son of Nun, a man in whom is the spirit of leadership, and lay your hand on him. Have him stand before Eleazar the priest and the entire assembly, and commission him in their presence. Give him some of your authority, so the whole Israelite community will obey him. He is to stand before Eleazar the priest, who will obtain decisions for him by inquiring of the Urim before the Lord. At his command, he and the entire community of the Israelites will go out, and at his command, they will come in."
Moses did as the Lord commanded him. He took Joshua and had him stand before Eleazar the priest and the whole assembly. Then he laid his hands on him and commissioned him, as the Lord instructed through Moses. The Lord said to Moses,
"Give this command to the Israelites, and say to them, make sure that you present to me at the appointed time my food offerings as an aroma pleasing to me. Say to them, this is the food offering you are to present to the Lord. 2 lambs a year old without defect, as a regular burnt offering each day. Offer 1 lamb in the morning and the other at twilight, together with a grain offering of 1/10 of an ephah of the finest flour mixed with 1/4 of a hin of oil from pressed olives. This is the regular burnt offering instituted at Mount Sinai as a pleasing aroma, a food offering presented to the Lord. The accompanying drink offering is to be 1/4 of a hin of fermented drink with each lamb. Pour out the drink offering to the Lord at the sanctuary. Offer the 2nd lamb at twilight, along with the same kind of grain offering and drink offering that you offer in the morning. This is a food offering, an aroma pleasing to the Lord. On the Sabbath day, make an offering of 2 lambs a year old without defect, together with its drink offering and a grain offering of 2/10 of an ephah of the finest flour mixed with olive oil. This is the burnt offering for every Sabbath, in addition to the regular burnt offering and its drink offering. On the 1st of every month, present to the Lord a burnt offering of 2 young bulls, 1 ram, and 7 male lambs a year old, all without defect. With each bull, there is to be a grain offering of 3/10 of an ephah of the finest flour mixed with oil. With the ram, a grain offering of 2/10 of an ephah of the finest flour mixed with oil, and with each lamb, a grain offering of 1/10 of an ephah of the finest flour mixed with oil. This is for a burnt offering, a pleasing aroma, a food offering presented to the Lord. With each bull, there is to be a drink offering of 1/2 hin of wine, with the ram, 1/3 hin, and with each lamb, 1/4 hin. This is the monthly burnt offering to be made at each new moon during the year. Besides the regular burnt offering with its drink offering, 1 male goat is to be presented to the Lord as a sin offering. On the 14th day of the 1st month, the Lord's Passover is to be held. On the 15th day of this month, there is to be a festival. For 7 days, eat bread made without yeast. On the 1st day, hold a sacred assembly and do no regular work. Present to the Lord a food offering consisting of a burnt offering of 2 young bulls, 1 ram, and 7 male lambs a year old, all without defect. With each bull, offer a grain offering of 3/10 of an ephah of the finest flour mixed with oil. With the ram, 2/10, and with each of the 7 lambs, 1/10. Include 1 male goat as a sin offering to make atonement for you. Offer these in addition to the regular morning burnt offering. In this way, present the food offering every day for 7 days as an aroma pleasing to the Lord. It is to be offered in addition to the regular burnt offering and its drink offering. On the 7th day, hold a sacred assembly and do no regular work. On the day of first fruits, when you present to the Lord an offering of new grain during the festival of weeks, hold a sacred assembly and do no regular work. Present a burnt offering of 2 young bulls, 1 ram, and 7 male lambs a year old as an aroma pleasing to the Lord. With each bull, there is to be a grain offering of 3/10 of an ephah of the finest flour mixed with oil. With the ram, 2/10, and with each of the 7 lambs, 1/10. Include 1 male goat to make atonement for you. Offer these together with their drink offerings, in addition to the regular burnt offering and its grain offering. Be sure the animals are without defect. On the 1st day of the 7th month, hold a sacred assembly and do no regular work. It is a day for you to sound the trumpets. As an aroma pleasing to the Lord, offer a burnt offering of one young bull, one ram, and seven male lambs a year old, all without defect. With the bull, offer a grain offering of 3/10 of an ephah of the finest flour mixed with olive oil. With the ram, 2/10, and with each of the seven lambs, 1/10. Include one male goat as a sin offering to make atonement for you. These are in addition to the monthly and daily burnt offerings with their grain offerings and drink offerings as specified. They are food offerings presented to the Lord, a pleasing aroma. On the 10th day of this 7th month, hold a sacred assembly. You must deny yourselves and do no work. Present as an aroma pleasing to the Lord a burnt offering of one young bull, one ram, and seven male lambs a year old, all without defect. With the bull, offer a grain offering of 3/10 of an ephah of the finest flour mixed with olive oil. With the ram, 2/10, and with each of the seven lambs, 1/10. Include one male goat as a sin offering, in addition to the sin offering for atonement and the regular burnt offering with its grain offering and their drink offerings. On the 15th day of the 7th month, hold a sacred assembly and do no regular work. Celebrate a festival to the Lord for 7 days. Present as an aroma pleasing to the Lord a food offering consisting of a burnt offering of 13 young bulls, 2 rams, and 14 male lambs a year old, all without defect. With each of the 13 bulls, offer a grain offering of 3/10 of an ephah of the finest flour mixed with olive oil. With each of the 2 rams, 2/10, and with each of the 14 lambs, 1/10. Include one male goat as a sin offering, in addition to the regular burnt offering with its grain offering and drink offering. On the 2nd day, offer 12 young bulls, 2 rams, and 14 male lambs a year old, all without defect. With the bulls, rams, and lambs, offer their grain offerings and drink offerings according to the number specified. Include one male goat as a sin offering, in addition to the regular burnt offering with its grain offering and their drink offerings. On the 3rd day, offer 11 bulls, 2 rams, and 14 male lambs a year old, all without defect. With the bulls, rams, and lambs, offer their grain offerings and drink offerings according to the number specified. Include one male goat as a sin offering, in addition to the regular burnt offering, with its grain offering and drink offering. On the 4th day, offer 10 bulls, 2 rams, and 14 male lambs a year old, all without defect. With the bulls, rams, and lambs, offer their grain offerings and drink offerings according to the number specified. Include one male goat as a sin offering in addition to the regular burnt offering with its grain offering and drink offering. On the 5th day, offer 9 bulls, 2 rams, and 14 male lambs a year old, all without defect. With the bulls, rams, and lambs, offer their grain offerings and drink offerings according to the number specified. Include one male goat as a sin offering, in addition to the regular burnt offering with its grain offering and drink offering. On the 6th day, offer 8 bulls, 2 rams, and 14 male lambs a year old, all without defect. With the bulls, rams, and lambs, offer their grain offerings and drink offerings according to the number specified. Include one male goat as a sin offering, in addition to the regular burnt offering with its grain offering and drink offering. On the 7th day, offer 7 bulls, 2 rams, and 14 male lambs a year old, all without defect. With the bulls, rams, and lambs, offer their grain offerings and drink offerings according to the number specified. Include one male goat as a sin offering, in addition to the regular burnt offering with its grain offering and drink offering. On the eighth day, hold a closing special assembly and do no regular work. Present as an aroma pleasing to the Lord, a food offering consisting of a burnt offering of one bull, one ram, and seven male lambs a year old, all without defect. With the bull, the ram, and the lambs, offer their grain offerings and drink offerings according to the number specified. Include one male goat as a sin offering, in addition to the regular burnt offering with its grain offering and drink offering. In addition to what you vow and your freewill offerings, offer these to the Lord at your appointed festivals. Your burnt offerings, grain offerings, drink offerings, and fellowship offerings.
Moses told the Israelites all that the Lord commanded him. Moses said to the heads of the tribes of Israel,
"This is what the Lord commands. When a man makes a vow to the Lord, or takes an oath to obligate himself by a pledge, he must not break his word, but must do everything he said. When a young woman still living in her father's household makes a vow to the Lord or obligates herself by a pledge, and her father hears about her vow or pledge but says nothing to her, then all her vows and every pledge by which she obligated herself will stand. But if her father forbids her when he hears about it, none of her vows or the pledges by which she obligated herself will stand. The Lord will release her because her father has forbidden her. If she marries after she makes a vow, or after her lips utter a rash promise by which she obligates herself, and her husband hears about it but says nothing to her, then her vows or the pledges by which she obligated herself will stand. But if her husband forbids her when he hears about it, he nullifies the vow that obligates her or the rash promise by which she obligates herself, and the Lord will release her. Any vow or obligation taken by a widow or divorced woman will be binding on her. If a woman living with her husband makes a vow or obligates herself by a pledge under oath, and her husband hears about it but says nothing to her and does not forbid her, then all her vows or the pledges by which she obligated herself will stand. But if her husband nullifies them when he hears about them, then none of the vows or pledges that came from her lips will stand. Her husband has nullified them, and the Lord will release her. Her husband may confirm or nullify any vow she makes or any sworn pledge to deny herself. But if her husband says nothing to her about it from day to day, then he confirms all her vows or the pledges binding on her. He confirms them by saying nothing to her when he hears about them. If, however, he nullifies them sometime after he hears about them, then he must bear the consequences of her wrongdoing."
These are the regulations the Lord gave Moses concerning relationships between a man and his wife, and between a father and his young daughter still living at home. The Lord said to Moses,
"Take vengeance on the Midianites for the Israelites. After that, you will be gathered to your people."
So Moses said to the people,
"Arm some of your men to go to war against the Midianites, so that they may carry out the Lord's vengeance on them. Send into battle 1,000 men from each of the tribes of Israel."
So 12,000 men armed for battle, 1,000 from each tribe, were supplied from the clans of Israel. Moses sent them into battle, 1,000 from each tribe, along with Phinehas, son of Eleazar, the priest, who took with him articles from the sanctuary and the trumpets for signaling. They fought against Midian as the Lord commanded Moses, and killed every man. Among their victims were Evi, Recham, Zur, Hur, and Reba, the five kings of Midian. They also killed Balaam, son of Beor, with the sword. The Israelites captured the Midianite women and children and took all the Midianite herds, flocks, and goods as plunder. They burned all the towns where the Midianites had settled, as well as all their camps. They took all the plunder and spoils, including the people and animals, and brought the captives, spoils, and plunder to Moses and Eleazar the priest and the Israelite assembly at their camp on the plains of Moab by the Jordan, across from Jericho. Moses, Eleazar the priest, and all the leaders of the community went to meet them outside the camp. Moses was angry with the officers of the army, the commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds who returned from the battle.
"Have you allowed all the women to live?"
he asked them.
"They were the ones who followed Balaam's advice and enticed the Israelites to be unfaithful to the Lord in the Peor incident, so that a plague struck the Lord's people. Now kill all the boys, and kill every woman who has slept with a man, but save for yourselves every girl who has never slept with a man. Anyone who has killed someone or touched someone who was killed must stay outside the camp 7 days. On the third and seventh days, you must purify yourselves and your captives. Purify every garment as well as everything made of leather, goat hair, or wood."
Then Eleazar the priest said to the soldiers who had gone into battle,
"This is what is required by the law that the Lord gave Moses: gold, silver, bronze, iron, tin, lead, and anything else that can withstand fire must be put through the fire, and then it will be clean. But it must also be purified with the water of cleansing. And whatever cannot withstand fire must be put through that water. On the seventh day, wash your clothes, and you will be clean. Then you may come into the camp."
The Lord said to Moses,
"You and Eleazar the priest and the family heads of the community are to count all the women and animals that were captured. Divide the spoils equally between the soldiers who took part in the battle and the rest of the community. From the soldiers who fought in the battle, set apart as tribute for the Lord, 1 out of every 500, whether women, cattle, donkeys, or sheep. Take this tribute from their half share and give it to Eleazar the priest as the Lord's part. From the Israelites' half, select 1 out of every 50, whether women, cattle, donkeys, sheep, or other animals. Give them to the Levites, who are responsible for the care of the Lord's tabernacle."
So Moses and Eleazar the priest did as the Lord commanded Moses. The plunder remaining from the spoils that the soldiers took was 675,000 sheep, 72,000 cattle, 61,000 donkeys, and 32,000 women who had never slept with a man. The half share of those who fought in the battle was 337,500 sheep, of which the tribute for the Lord was 675, 36,000 cattle, of which the tribute for the Lord was 72, 30,500 donkeys, of which the tribute for the Lord was 61, 16,000 women, of whom the tribute for the Lord was 32. Moses gave the tribute to Eleazar the priest as the Lord's part, as the Lord commanded Moses. The half belonging to the Israelites, which Moses set apart from that of the fighting men, the community's half, was 337,500 sheep, 36,000 cattle, 30,500 donkeys, and 16,000 women. From the Israelites' half, Moses selected 1 out of every 50 women and animals, as the Lord commanded him, and gave them to the Levites, who were responsible for the care of the Lord's tabernacle. Then the officers who were over the units of the army, the commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds, went to Moses and said to him,
"Your servants have counted the soldiers under our command, and not one is missing. So we have brought as an offering to the Lord the gold articles each of us acquired: armlets, bracelets, signet rings, earrings, and necklaces, to make atonement for ourselves before the Lord."
Moses and Eleazar the priest accepted from them the gold, all the crafted articles, all the gold from the commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds that Moses and Eleazar presented as a gift to the Lord weighed 16,750 shekels. Each soldier had taken plunder for himself. Moses and Eleazar the priest accepted the gold from the commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds and brought it into the tent of meeting as a memorial for the Israelites before the Lord. The Reubenites and Gadites, who had very large herds and flocks, saw that the lands of Jazer and Gilead were suitable for livestock. So they came to Moses and Eleazar the priest, and to the leaders of the community, and said,
Ataroth, Dibon, Jazer, Nimrah, Heshbon, Elealah, Sebam, Nebo, and beyond. The land the Lord subdued before the people of Israel are suitable for livestock, and your servants have livestock. If we have found favor in your eyes, let this land be given to your servants as our possession. Do not make us cross the Jordan.
Moses said to the Gadites and Reubenites,
Should your own people go to war while you sit here? Why do you discourage the Israelites from crossing over into the land the Lord has given them? This is what your fathers did when I sent them from Kadesh Barnea to look over the land. After they went up to the valley of Eshcol and viewed the land, they discouraged the Israelites from entering the land the Lord had given them. The Lord's anger was aroused that day, and he swore this oath.
Because they have not followed me wholeheartedly, not one of those who were 20 years old or more when they came up out of Egypt will see the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Not one, except Caleb, son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, and Joshua, son of Nun. For they followed the Lord wholeheartedly.
The Lord's anger burned against Israel, and he made them wander in the wilderness 40 years, until the whole generation of those who had done evil in his sight was gone. And here you are, a brood of sinners, standing in the place of your fathers and making the Lord even more angry with Israel. If you turn away from following him, he will again leave all this people in the wilderness, and you will be the cause of their destruction.
Then they came up to him and said,
We would like to build pens here for our livestock, cities for our women and children, but we will arm ourselves for battle and go ahead of the Israelites until we have brought them to their place. Meanwhile, our women and children will live in fortified cities for protection from the inhabitants of the land. We will not return to our homes until all the Israelites have received their inheritance. We will not receive any inheritance with them on the other side of the Jordan, because our inheritance has come to us on the east side of the Jordan.
Then Moses said to them,
If you will do this, if you will arm yourselves before the Lord for battle, and if all of you who are armed cross over the Jordan before the Lord until he has driven his enemies out before him, then when the land is subdued before the Lord, you may return and be free from your obligation to the Lord and to Israel. And this land will be your possession before the Lord. But if you fail to do this, you will be sinning against the Lord, and you may be sure that your sin will find you out. Build cities for your women and children and pens for your flocks, but do what you have promised.
The Gadites and Reubenites said to Moses,
We, your servants, will do as our Lord commands. Our children and wives, our flocks and herds will remain here in the cities of Gilead. But your servants, every man who is armed for battle will cross over to fight before the Lord, just as our Lord said.
Then Moses gave orders about them to Eleazar the priest and Joshua son of Nun and to the family heads of the Israelite tribes. He said to them,
If the Gadites and Reubenites, all those armed for battle, cross over the Jordan with you before the Lord. Then, when the land is subdued before you, you must give them the land of Gilead as their possession. But if they do not cross over with you armed, they must accept their possession with you in Canaan.
The Gadites and Reubenites answered,
"Your servants will do what the Lord has said. We will cross over before the Lord into Canaan armed. But the property we inherit will be on this side of the Jordan."
Then Moses gave to the Gadites, the Reubenites, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, son of Joseph, the kingdom of Sihon, king of the Amorites, and the kingdom of Og, king of Bashan, the whole land with its cities and the territory around them. The Gadites built up Dibon, Ataroth, Aurora, Atroth-Shofen, Jazer, Jokbahar, Beth-Nimrah, and Beth-Haran as fortified cities, and built pens for their flocks. And the Reubenites rebuilt Heshbon, Elealeh, and Kiriathaim, as well as Nebo and Baal-Meon. These names were changed, and Sibmah. They gave names to the cities they rebuilt. The descendants of Machir, son of Manasseh, went to Gilead, captured it, and drove out the Amorites who were there. So Moses gave Gilead to the Machirites, the descendants of Manasseh, and they settled there. Jair, a descendant of Manasseh, captured their settlements and called them Havoth-Jair. And Nobah captured Kenith and its surrounding settlements and called it Nobah after himself. Here are the stages in the journey of the Israelites when they came out of Egypt by divisions under the leadership of Moses and Aaron. At the Lord's command, Moses recorded the stages in their journey. This is their journey by stages. The Israelites set out from Ramses on the 15th day of the first month, the day after the Passover. They marched out defiantly in full view of all the Egyptians who were burying all their firstborn, whom the Lord had struck down among them. For the Lord had brought judgment on their gods. The Israelites left Ramses and camped at Succoth. They left Succoth and camped at Etam on the edge of the desert. They left Etam, turned back to Pi-Hahiroth, to the east of Baal-Zephon, and camped near Migdol. They left Pi-Hahiroth and passed through the sea into the desert, and when they had traveled for 3 days in the desert of Etam, they camped at Marah. They left Marah and went to Elim, where there were 12 springs and 70 palm trees, and they camped there. They left Elim and camped by the Red Sea. They left the Red Sea and camped in the desert of Sin. They left the desert of Sin and camped at Dophkah. They left Dophkah and camped at Elish. They left Elish and camped at Rephidim, where there was no water for the people to drink. They left Rephidim and camped in the desert of Sinai. They left the desert of Sinai and camped at Kibroth Hataavah. They left Kibroth Hataavah and camped at Huzirath. They left Huzirath and camped at Rithmah. They left Rithmah and camped at Rimmon Perez. They left Rimmon Perez and camped at Libnah. They left Libnah and camped at Rissa. They left Rissa and camped at Kehulatha. They left Kehulatha and camped at Mount Shefer. They left Mount Shefer and camped at Hereda. They left Hereda and camped at Machelath. They left Machelath and camped at Tahath. They left Tahath and camped at Terah. They left Terah and camped at Mithka. They left Mithka and camped at Hashmona. They left Hashmona and camped at Mosirath. They left Mosirith and camped at Bene-Jaokan. They left Bene-Jaokan and camped at Hor-Hagidgad. They left Hor-Hagidgad and camped at Jotbatha. They left Jotbatha and camped at Abrona. They left Abrona and camped at Ezion-Geber. They left Ezion-Geber and camped at Kadesh in the desert of Zin. They left Kadesh and camped at Mount Hor on the border of Edom. At the Lord's command, Aaron, the priest, went up Mount Hor, where he died on the first day of the fifth month of the 40th year after the Israelites came out of Egypt. Aaron was 123 years old when he died on Mount Hor. The Canaanite king of Arad, who lived in the Negev of Canaan, heard that the Israelites were coming. They left Mount Hor and camped at Zalmona. They left Zalmona and camped at Punan. They left Punan and camped at Oboth. They left Oboth and camped at Ayir Abarim on the border of Moab. They left Ayir Abarim and camped at Dibon Gad. They left Dibon Gad and camped at Almon Diblathaim. They left Almon Diblathaim and camped in the mountains of Abarim near Nebo. They left the mountains of Abarim and camped on the plains of Moab by the Jordan, across from Jericho. There, on the plains of Moab, they camped along the Jordan, from Beth Jeshimoth to Abel Shittim. On the plains of Moab by the Jordan, across from Jericho, the Lord said to Moses,
"Speak to the Israelites and say to them, when you cross the Jordan into Canaan, drive out all the inhabitants of the land before you. Destroy all their carved images and their cast idols, and demolish all their high places. Take possession of the land and settle in it, for I have given you the land to possess. Distribute the land by lot, according to your clans. To a larger group, give a larger inheritance, and to a smaller group, a smaller one. Whatever falls to them by lot will be theirs. Distribute it according to your ancestral tribes. But if you do not drive out the inhabitants of the land, those you allow to remain will become barbs in your eyes and thorns in your sides. They will give you trouble in the land where you would live, and then I will do to you what I plan to do to them."
The Lord said to Moses,
"Command the Israelites, and say to them, when you enter Canaan, the land that will be allotted to you as an inheritance is to have these boundaries. Your southern side will include some of the desert of Zin along the border of Edom. Your southern boundary will start in the east from the southern end of the Dead Sea. Cross south of Scorpion Pass, continue on to Zin, and go south of Kadesh Barnea. Then it will go to Hazar Adah and over to Asmon, where it will turn, join the Wadi of Egypt, and end at the Mediterranean Sea. Your western boundary will be the coast of the Mediterranean Sea. This will be your boundary on the west. For your northern boundary, run a line from the Mediterranean Sea to Mount Hor, and from Mount Hor to Lebo Hamath. Then the boundary will go to Zedad, continue to Ziphron, and end at Hazar Enan. This will be your boundary on the north. For your eastern boundary, run a line from Hazar Enan to Shepham. The boundary will go down from Shepham to Ribla on the east side of Ain and continue along the slopes east of the Sea of Galilee. Then the boundary will go down along the Jordan and end at the Dead Sea. This will be your land with its boundaries on every side."
Moses commanded the Israelites,
"Assign this land by lot as an inheritance. The Lord has ordered that it be given to the 9.5 tribes, because the families of the tribe of Reuben, the tribe of Gad, and the half tribe of Manasseh have received their inheritance. These 2.5 tribes have received their inheritance east of the Jordan, across from Jericho, toward the sunrise.
The Lord said to Moses,
"These are the names of the men who are to assign the land for you as an inheritance: Eleazar the priest, and Joshua son of Nun, and appoint one leader from each tribe to help assign the land. These are their names: Caleb, son of Jephunneh, from the tribe of Judah; Shemuel, son of Amihud, from the tribe of Simeon; Eliadad, son of Kislon, from the tribe of Benjamin; Buki, son of Jogli, the leader from the tribe of Dan; Haniel, son of Ephod, the leader from the tribe of Manasseh, son of Joseph; Shemuel."
Inspired by the Bible Experience.
Try, you know, but the words won't. So I just keep trying.